I think so.
The sound is okay?
Yeah, the sound is okay. Yes. We have the victory all the time. Okay, over to you, sir.
Yes, okay. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. Let's just read that place. These are scriptures that help us. All right. It says, for the time you ought to be teachers, you still need to be taught the first principles of the doctrine of Christ. So, and then I become like those who are in need of milk instead of strong meat. So there are phases in every believer's life. So there's the first phase is your discipleship season, and the next phase is your apostolic season. So every believer has two seasons in their life. They are the discipleship season and the apostolic season. Every believer has two seasons in their life. The discipleship season, that's where you are being trained and taught and prepared for ministry. And the other season is called the apostolic season. So Paul is talking about that when he says, when for the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again. So with these scriptures already put in place, I think we're ready now to proceed with our definitions. Yesterday we tried to use words, other words, to help describe the word disciple. The first one we used the word supporter, believer, follower, adherent, apostle, attendant, booster. The booster one was very important. Other words would be buff, B-U-F-F. Disciple is a buff, a devotee, well-informed, somebody who's well-informed about somebody's following. So there's nothing you want to know about a person or a ministry, a disciple cannot tell you. He knows everything about the work. And that word is bug. One who has great enthusiasm, B-U-G, a bug. These are words some of us are familiar with. Then the other word is a convert. Disciple is also a convert. You know, the other word is devotee. Devotee. Disciple is a devotee. A devotee is a person who is greatly devoted to something or someone. They are loyal, and they don't leave. They don't turn away from what they are devoted to. So, another word is enthusiast. A disciple is an enthusiast. A person who is filled with enthusiasm for some principle, pursuit, or of a person. An inspired follower. Okay. The next word is fan. I'm just running through it because of time. Just write this word down, fan, F-A-N. Disciple is a fan. Just imagine a fan. Some of us are fans of celebrities, fans of musicians. So in a way, you're a disciple. If you notice, most fans know everything about the person they are fanning. Praise the Lord. So A fan is current, a fan is devoted, a fan can fight for. I've seen guys fighting, like we have what we call Arsenal fans, Chelsea fans, you know. And, you know, these are fans. These fans, they can get very emotional, you know. You dare not insult their club in front of them or say something off. You could actually, you know, get a punch. So a disciple is a fan of a ministry, fan of a, you know, there is a follower. All right. Then the other words, like things like just few words left. Fanatic, write these words down. Fanatic. Disciple is a fanatic. Disciple is a fanatic. It's a person with an extreme and uncritical enthusiasm or zeal, as in a religion or politics. We have example of fanatics, you know, in our cousins, the Muslims. Those people, so you know, the way they protect and defend their prophets, you can't even insult their prophets, you know, because they love their prophets and they respect him. So that's what we say. These are disciples. They can fight. Okay. A true disciple of Christ won't sit back and watch the name of Jesus denigrated in public or his church or his pastor. Disciple will fight for his leader. When someone has said something complimentary, he will try to defend. Fight doesn't mean physically fighting, but defending, you know, standing up to. All right, that's what we need to see more of. Then, disciple is also a fiend. A fiend. F-I-E-N-D. And then, this last one is funny. Disciple is a freak, too. Disciple is a freak, a devoted fan or follower. One thing about freaks is that they stand out. They stand out. They don't try to blend in. They don't compromise. Are you a Jesus freak? The early apostles were Jesus freaks. A freak is any abnormal, phenomenal, or product of unusual object, an anomaly, an aberration, something exhibiting a strange deviation from nature. So are you a normal Christian, or do people find you unusual and fascinating? So disciples are easy to notice. If people can't tell where you stand, then there's something wrong with you as a disciple. So these are English words that we can use. But then what I want to talk about today is what I call the marks of a disciple. Marks of a disciple. That's so right beheading, marks of a disciple. We've gone through the definitions. You can do your own personal study on those ones. Let's move on because of time. Because I want to, at the point, begin to introduce some of these codes. What are the scriptures? Is that scriptures that help you to identify a disciple? All right, let's see the first scripture. The first principle is one, a disciple puts the kingdom first. So these are marks of a disciple. These are things disciples are known for. Number one, they put the kingdom first. The disciple puts the kingdom first. Matthew chapter 8, verse 21. And another disciple said unto him, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. But Jesus said unto him, follow me and let the dead bury their dead. So the disciple, it's not that other things are not important, but to a disciple, the kingdom comes first. The kingdom comes first. Until you come to that point, you're not a disciple yet. You can be any that you want to call yourself. And let me even add something. It's very strange. But the Bible said that the Christians were first called, disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. That's a very strange statement there. They were first called Christians in Antioch. What does that mean? It tells you that if you are not a disciple, then how can you really be a Christian? To be Christian means to be Christ-like. So the process of making you a Christian begins with discipleship. They were first called Christians in Antioch. You can find that in the book of Acts. He says the disciples were first called Christians. So you can find that before you can even call yourself a Christian, you have to first of all be a disciple. Because a Christian is somebody who is Christ-like. So if you don't understand discipleship, then you're going to always come out to look like a fake Christian. So the process of actually making you a Christian, the word can really refer to, is discipleship. In Acts chapter 11, verse 26, and when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch, and it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. So first, a disciple before a Christian. But now you're a Christian if you have a Christian name, you're a Christian if you're born by Christian parents, you're a Christian if you go to church. We've turned it the other way around. The word Christian means Christ-like, to look like Christ, to be like Christ. So the process of making you like Christ is discipleship. So they were first called Christians in Antioch, but they were disciples first. So before we even talk about Christianity, whether you're a Christian, that's what a lot of people are messing up. And people say, look at what Christians, this is, and they say, these are Christians? They are not Christians. If you've not undergone this discipleship, you can't really be a Christian. You can't really be called a Christian in the true sense of the word. They were, and the word Christian was a word they used in mockery. You know, these Christians, you know, these people, you know, if it's in our time, I don't know what I will use now. You know, if a particular celebrity is so popular and they use his name, to coin the name of his followers. So they say Christians, you know, these Christians, because they were like so much like Christ. But, you know, so we need to, you know, not forget that. All right. So the first principle we have seen is that a disciple puts the kingdom first. And we have looked at scriptures on that. The second principle is that disciples are followers. We've taught a little bit on that yesterday. I'm giving you scriptures now. Matthew chapter 9, verse 19. Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. He said to Peter, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Disciples are followers. Okay? Be followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. Disciples are followers. All right, that's the second principle. The third principle from scriptures, we pointed on this yesterday. I just want to give it to you as a teaching. Jesus gives power to his disciples. This subject is called marks of a disciple. The first one we saw is that they put the kingdom first. The second thing we saw is that they are followers. So a disciple follows the ministry, follows the man, follows the leader. All right, number three, he gives power to his disciples. Matthew chapter 10, verse 1, when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. So power is given to disciples. He did not just call the people who are following him, the crowd. He called disciples and gave them power. So power is released to disciples. So if you are a disciple, you're already powerful. Number four, this critical number four, the disciple is not above his master. A disciple understands in his mind that he is subordinate to the person God has placed over him. It's a decision you have to take in discipleship, in the church, in this church setting, in your relationship with your pastor. You have to mentally subordinate yourself under him. Disciple is not above his master. Disciple tries never to be above his master in anything. He always tries to exalt his master so that God can exalt him. He says, it's not your job to exalt yourself. Your job is to exalt the person above you. It is God that will exalt you. When you start exalting yourself, it's called pride, and God will resist you. But if you exalt the person God has placed over you, that's humility. God will now see it. And also, so when you are doing everything to make your pastor look good, make your church look good, you're serving, you're bringing yourself under, you know, That is what attracts the grace of God to you. But if you are trying to promote yourself, project yourself, make yourself look more important than you really are, and then these are things that God will say, who is this person? Because for a man to go from level A to level B, God has to approve it. You can't raise your head without God. It is actually rebellion to try to promote yourself without God. So the disciple understands, you know, that his master, Matthew chapter 10, verse 24, the disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. The disciple knows that his master is greater than him, and so he assumes the place of a servant before him. Most of us have problems in this area. We're like, we're all born again, we're all children of God. Yes, we are. But even in your father's house, you have senior brothers and you have junior brothers. Yes. And they don't have the same rights and authority in a normal house. There are some families that are dysfunctional, where even the children can beat the parents. That's I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a real normal family. All right. So even though we're all children of God, we have seniors in the kingdom. The Bible says, let the junior submit himself to the elder. So that we have elders and we have, so understand that when you come to church, the pastor is your spiritual superior. Your leader is a spiritual. So you mentally accept it. Don't fight it. You know, stay, bring yourself under and let God lift you. Disciples understand that their master is above them. Okay? They don't come into, for example, they don't come into a room, you know, and normally if their master comes in, the pastor comes in, they show respect. They get up and welcome him, that kind of stuff. You know, not because they're slaves, but because they understand the principle of the kingdom. You know, in everything they defer to their leader, because they understand discipleship. Understand that these are things that attracts grace. Let me say it again. It is not your job to promote yourself. It is God that will promote you. Your job is to promote your leader. As you're busy promoting your leader, God will promote you. That's how it works. When you start promoting yourself, God will demote you. Watch it. That's how it has always worked. Okay? Because what you make happen for others is what God will make happen for you. Jesus even said in the principle of giving, give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Shall men. So what you do for the person above you, God will cause others to do to you. Okay? So the disciple understands. I just quoted 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5. I'll read it again. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. 1 Peter 5, 5. So there's submission. A disciple submits himself to his authority, the authority placed over him, his father, his spiritual mother. Okay? Don't come to the church and be calling your pastor by his first name, or calling the wife by her name. You call her mommy. Call him daddy. That's how you understand this thing. That's how it works. I'm not really crazy about father and daddy, mommy, all those things, but the scriptures. It's not like we're looking, come and call me daddy. Come and call me daddy. Don't call me daddy. No. We don't really need it. It doesn't add blood to us. But the scripture is the scripture. So he said, let likewise ye younger submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another and be clothed with humility. Why? For God resisted the proud. Who is the proud? The one that exalts himself. And giveth grace to the humble. The one that humbles himself under somebody, that's the one that attracts grace. You want to attract grace in 2020, then submit yourself physically. You're not humble until you have a physical authority over you that you respect and follow and obey. Can I say it again? You're not considered as humble until you have a physical human authority placed over you that you respect, honor, and obey. And when God looks at you, he looks for the authority over you. If there's no authority over you, he sees you as a rebel. So as you're in this church system, you know, understand the principle of discipleship. A disciple is not above his master. So in every effort, try to promote your leader above yourself. Above yourself. I like what Elisha did. When Elijah came and called him and said, come and follow me as a disciple. He was very rich and he had a lot of cattle. And what did he do? Because the disciple cannot be above his master. He went and, you know, slaughtered all those things and sold everything and burnt everything and came as nobody. So that when Elijah is talking, he will be able to listen. A young man came to Jesus, very rich. What can I do to have eternal life? The young man said. Jesus said, you know the laws now. Do this, do that. You know, the man said, I've kept this for my youth. Is there anything else? He looked at the young man and saw the arrogance in him. But the Bible said he loved him. He now said, you lack only one thing. He said, go and sell all that you have and give it to the poor. And then come and follow me. So in discipleship, you must reduce yourself. That's the principle there. You must reduce yourself so that you can stay under. If your social status is a problem, you cannot be discipled. If your family name is a problem, you cannot be discipled. If your education is a problem, you cannot be discipled. Jesus said it is impossible for a rich man to enter the kingdom. That's discipleship. Discipleship is a process of entering the kingdom. He said it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man. So he's trying to say that if you attach too much importance to, you know, these things, title, name, wealth, power, You cannot be anybody's disciple. Therefore, God cannot touch you. Can we receive this message? Are we really receiving this? So, but if you, and the man, the Bible says, the man became very sorrowful in his heart and left. Why? Because he had much possession. One man said, he didn't have much possessions. Much possessions had him. He didn't have much wealth. Much wealth had him. So the problem we're having in a society is that people want to come to Jesus. You know, in salvation, come as you are. In discipleship, no, you can't come as you are. You have to bring yourself down. You have to humble yourself. You have to. God never humbles anybody. Let me say this. God never humbles anybody. He tells people, humble yourself. God does not humble people. Read the whole Bible. Everywhere the Bible says, humble yourself. It doesn't humble anybody. He only humiliates those that refuse to humble themselves. He allows you to humble yourself, bring yourself under, that I may exalt you. So while you are busy, bring yourself lower and lower and lower in the eyes of men. God will take you higher and higher. That's how it works. Which one is better, you lifting yourself or God lifting you? If man lifts you, if you lift yourself, you can come down. Gravity will bring you down. But if God lifts you, who can bring you down? He said he giveth grace to the humble. What you need is grace. What you need is grace. Receive grace in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive grace in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive grace to submit to authority. Submit. You cannot be a vagabond. He said those vagabond Jews saw what Paul did and said, if Paul can do it, we can do it too. And they looked for a madman. They thought he was friendly. And they said to that madman, in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preached, come out, come out. The young man looked at them, sized them. There were seven of them, seven vagabonds. Who is a vagabond? A vagabond is a person who doesn't have a spiritual authority over him. And if you're a lady watching me, don't marry a vagabond. Don't submit yourself to somebody who doesn't have an authority over him. It's dangerous. Before we go find that relationship, ask him, who is your pastor? What's your relationship with your pastor? Who is your father? Who speaks into your life? If you can answer that question, it's a disaster waiting to happen. To tell the truth, these vagabonds had no authority over them. And the demons recognize that. They say, Jesus, we know. Paul, we know. But who are you? Who are you? They couldn't answer, who are you? He pounced on them and tore them to pieces. You can read that in Acts chapter 19. Hallelujah. So, when you surrender, submit to authority, you carry grace. I see grace coming on somebody tonight. Grace. The mountain moving grace. It says, who art thou, O mountain before Zerubbabel? You shall become a level land, for you shall take the headstone thereof, crying grace, grace. So when you cry grace, mountains move. But he giveth grace to the humble. He giveth grace to the humble. Receive grace. Receive grace. Grace is simply the help of God. Grace is the assistance of God. The Bible says, let us come to the throne of grace. Grace has a throne. Grace is a king. In the affairs of life, grace is king. When you come to the throne of grace, come and submit yourself to grace. He said that you may find, that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. So grace is the help you need when you need it. Receive grace. So there are two types of people on earth. There are two types of people on earth, two types of Christians. Those that are being helped by God and those that are being resisted by God. Some of us, what you're fighting is not devil, it's God. You bound and bound, you prayed for 20 days, 1 year, it's not moving. Check, it may be God. Because if it's devil, you would have left since. You can't bind God. You can't cast him out. Hallelujah. He said he resisted the proud. He stands in the way of the proud. He sets himself against the proud. Disciple understands. When your pastor rebukes you, God watches your heart. He checks you. And you say, who is he talking to? Does he know that we are professionals? Does he know that we are lawyers? Who cares what you are? When you die, you'll be nothing but dust and ashes. You'll be nothing but a mass of clay decaying. You're nothing. You're nothing. We are nothing. I'm nothing. So what's the boasting about? What's the pride about? Nothing. We have nothing. So that's the fourth principle. This is getting deeper and deeper. So find ways to let God know that you have submitted yourself to your pastor, because God is watching you. He says, I love the Bible. He said, humble yourself in the sight of God. That means let God observe you humbling yourself. Humble yourself in the sight of God. You see them carry something, you come and help them. You will find a way to be of service. Humble yourself in the sight of God, and he will lift you up in due season. There's a due season coming to somebody watching me. This year, the Lord shall lift you up. The Lord shall lift you up. The Lord shall lift you up in the name of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's move on. Number five principle. We're looking at the marks of disciple. We're just trying to, I don't know whether this is helping anybody. Is anybody being helped out there? Is anybody being helped out there?
Yes.
Yeah, Pastor.
God bless you. I hope you will still shake my hands after today. I'm just good. Let's carry on. Number five. The disciple will be like his master. The disciple will be like, that's the fifth principle. Matthew chapter 10, verse 25. Disciple will be like his master. Matthew chapter 10, verse 25. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master, and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his household? If they call Jesus, who was the holy man, devil, what do you think they will call you? You that is not that holy. A disciple does not seek to be treated better than his master. A disciple does not seek to be treated better than his master. He doesn't seek to be friends with the enemies of his master, enemy of his leader. No. You can't despise my church. You can't despise my pastor and then try to befriend me. It doesn't work like that. If they called me Beelzebub, what should they call you? So the enemy of your pastor is your enemy. The enemy of your church is your enemy. He's not your friend. When you sit down with them and they are tearing your church down, tearing your pastor down, tearing the work of God and making comments, don't keep quiet. They are not your friends. Secondly, is that the future of every disciple is to be like his master. So you can predict who you're going to be by who is discipling you. So if you want to be a doctor should disciple you. If you want to be a lawyer should disciple you. If you want to be a great person in the kingdom, then submit yourself to those who are ahead of you. He said the master. So a disciple is a future master. A disciple is a future master. A disciple is a future Lord. So today you're a disciple, tomorrow you're a Lord. Today you're a disciple, tomorrow you're a master. So I can tell where you are going if I see you undergoing discipleship. I know the future is yours. I know you're going to take over tomorrow, because the future belongs to disciples. The future belongs to disciples. In God's economy, in God's scheme of things, the future belongs to disciples. If you're not being discipled now, you will not future in God's future program. You will not future in God's future program if you're not under discipleship now. So where is God going to promote the next generals, the next women, the next men? They are those in the boot camp of discipleship right now. Hallelujah. So he said a disciple today is a master tomorrow. A master today was a disciple yesterday. Today's servant is tomorrow's Lord. The journey to the top begins with discipleship. God never promotes undiscipled people. Such promotions usually lead to destruction. Paul said somewhere, appoint a novice, lest he falls into the condemnation of Satan. That's pride. Any power you give to any person undiscipled will produce what? Power. I mean pride. Giving power to this undiscipled people will only produce what? Pride. You know why? Because discipleship kills the flesh. Discipleship teaches you it's not about you, it's about God. So you die to yourself. Once that death has taken place, whatever God can trust you with honor. God can trust you with money. God can trust you with power, because he knows that the flesh is dead. But when he looks and sees that it's all you, why will he give power to you? If you are God, he wouldn't give power to you now. I mean, if you are God, praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Number six, what you do for a disciple, you do for his master. Matthew chapter 10, verse 42. Whosoever shall give to drink unto one of these little ones a cup of cold water only in the name of a disciple, verily I say unto you, he shall in no wise lose his reward. A disciple is an ambassador of his master to men. As you treat him, so you treat the one he represents. The honor and favor of the master falls on the disciple. So whoever honors Jesus honors his disciples. Whoever hates Jesus hates his disciples. Stop seeking to be loved by those that hate your master, Jesus, and your church. We pointed this out. Take sides. See, we have to take sides. Stop being neutral, though. You can't be neutral this last days. I was giving a teaching. I'm running a series, what I call Decoding the Mark of the Beast and then Unmasking Antichrist. That happening at the same time. We were able to trace where the whole rivalry began. The rivalry began in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. There was a rivalry that began there, and God was one that declared it. He said to the serpent, I will put enmity. Enmity in Hebrew means hostility and hatred. I will put enmity between you and the woman. That's Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Between your seed and her seed. You know, thou shalt bruise his heel, and it shall crush your head. Now, two seeds are mentioned here. The seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. So we know who the seed of the woman is. The seed of the woman is Jesus Christ. But who is the seed of the serpent? The seed of the serpent is the Antichrist. So from that point, the battle lines were drawn between those who belong to the woman and those who belong to the serpent. So what is salvation? Salvation is that you are converted from the seed of the serpent and you have now become part of the seed of the woman, which is Christ. You can't be in a battle, in a war, and be in two sides. You have to choose a side. Are you for God? Are you against God? The Bible says friendship with the world is enmity with God. You can't be for and against. No. You have to choose ye this day whom you will serve. Are you of Christ? Are you of the church? Are you just, you know, sitting on the fence, trying to see what's happening here? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Number seven, disciples are commandable. Disciples are commandable. Disciples can be commanded. These are the processes that God is going to take you through beyond this training. You're going to be, some of you are even nodding and say, wow. Okay, so that thing happened to me was discipleship. God is testing me in my discipleship. Okay, thank you, Lord. I did not fail the test. I'm sorry I failed the test, whatever the case. Let's see Matthew chapter 11, verse 1. And it came to pass. Are you there? When Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples. So we watch who we command. The pastor watches who he gives certain instruction to. If they treat you like a sacred cow in the church, you should go and weep for your soul. If there are things they can't ask you to do because they are afraid of hurting your feelings or they are afraid of, you know, making you feel bad, then you have a real problem. Disciples can become, but if they can call you, it's a privilege to be called and given a task. It's a sign that the kingdom of heaven is yours. For blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Hallelujah. But if you are still in that place in the church where when they want to do certain things, they call certain people and they don't call you, start crying, start weeping. Go to the pastor and cry and say, no, command me. Command me. Tell me what to do. Tell me what to do and I'll do it. Hallelujah. Matthew 11 verse 1, and it came to pass when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed thence to teach and to preach. So disciples I have other scriptures, but we don't have time, you know, but Jesus would command them and they would go and do. So if you're humble enough to take instructions, then you are ready for the process God is trying to take you through. Somebody said that your mentor is also your tormentor. If you have a pastor who is nice to you, who does not tell you to do things, it's nice, so it's cool, but there's a problem. God said, as many as I love, I chastise and I rebuke. He says, who is that child that cannot be chastised or corrected, except that child be a bastard? If you are truly a son, have you noticed that the way you treat your neighbor's children. It's not how you treat your children. There are things your neighbor's children will do. You will laugh. Oh, Kelly, you're so naughty. Kelly, don't do that again. You know, you're being careful. But you're, if you're such a child, you just look at that child with your eyes. The child will understand you. So the same way, if God, you know, if they're too nice around you, you're not yet a disciple. I'm not saying you have to be harsh to disciples, but the process of discipleship cuts the flesh. It cuts the flesh because the flesh is the problem. The flesh has to die. The Bible says that the flesh and the spirit are at variance. Discipleship is a process of cutting off the flesh so the spirit can have ascendancy. Are you getting that now? Praise the Lord in the house. Now, I bet this thing has been recorded. So some of we can go back and play it. All right. Number 8, disciples are sent on errands. Matthew 11, verse 2. When John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of the disciples. Disciples are sent on errands. Can you be sent on errands? They are servants. They have the spirit of a servant. Number 9, disciples are like family to Jesus. Matthew chapter 12, verse 49. They said to him, unto him, behold, thy mother and thy brethren stand without. You know how they stood outside. Like they were not part of what was happening here. You know, desiring to speak with them is liberal to a preaching council and talk to them. But he answered and said unto them, that told him, who is my mother and who are my brethren? And he stretched forth his hand towards his disciples and said, behold, my mother and my brethren. Behold. So a disciple is a member of Jesus' family. A disciple is a member. And so should he be of yours too. If you have the disciple, you have a brother. If you have a disciple, you have a sister. And if you have disciples all over the world, it means you have family everywhere. It means if I come into a city and a disciple is there, I have a house there. You know, if a disciple has a work, you know, and I'm looking for work, he has to consider me first. We are family. We are one. Praise the Lord in the house with Christ. So treat every disciple like your sibling, like you would treat your sibling. Treat them the same way because you are of the same family. Praise the Lord. Number 10, disciples do the will of God. Disciples do the will of God, Matthew 12:50. Number 11, disciples, it is given to disciples to know the mysteries of God. That's number 11. Now, I'm going to branch a little bit and introduce the concept of the codes. There are 7 codes, and they're all in this book. This is reading the wrong way. I don't know. All you see is discipleship codes. Now, this book has been printed many, many times, and it's been used many places for discipleship training. We're actually reproducing, making some new copies as I speak. And there's also a link where you can actually get a copy. You need to read it. Now, the whole idea of this discipleship codes is to give you the basics of discipleship, the basics, okay? So there are the 7 basic things. I want to introduce them. If we're unable to have like how many minutes more, I'll introduce them one by one. And then we'll discuss a little bit. And then tomorrow, we'll now do a lot of work on discipleship codes. I'm taking a break from this other one so I can introduce the codes. All right? The whole idea of the codes is found in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. 1 Timothy 3, verse 15. If you can project it, that would be very nice. The code teaches you the behavior of disciples. This is how to behave as a disciple. And it's all written here. And it has transformed many, many lives. Your life will never be the same again. I believe already God is transforming your life. Okay, praise the Lord. So we're going to just introduce the codes. First of all, can I have projected 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15? It says, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of the truth. So there is how to behave in the house of God. There is how to behave in the house of God. Discipleship code is you know, and is a behavior training system that conforms your spirit man to agree with the character and the nature of God. Let me say this, and I'll say it quickly. The moment God sees his nature in a man, he releases his power on that man. The moment God sees his nature in somebody, he releases his kingdom, his power on that person. You don't need to pray for power. If you carry the character of God, you will command the power of God. If you carry the character of God, you will command the wealth of God. If you carry the behavior, if you manifest the behavior of God, you will naturally experience the blessings of heaven and the treasures of the kingdom. So as you're busy trying to conform into these codes, you will see your life changing. You will see people's perception of you changing. You will see even that, you know, your Christian life is making progress because you have experienced a mind shift. All right, so let's introduce the code because that's part of what we're doing here. Having looked at 1 Timothy 3:15, what are the codes? There are about 7 codes discussed here in this first installment. And they are, number one, what are the codes we're going to look at briefly in making a disciple? Number one, service. Service. Number two, unity. Number three, loyalty. Number four, humility. Number five, stewardship. Number six, obedience. Number seven, love. That is the first installment. Number one, service. Two, unity, loyalty, humility, stewardship, obedience, and love. So God has given me the grace to take this training to many, 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 many churches around the country, and many more even in front, because people are realizing more and more that doing anything else without raising disciples is just a waste of time. Waste of time, waste of 20 years of ministry, 50 years of ministry. I went somewhere and I was teaching on this. An old man was crying. He said, "Why are you crying, sir?" He said, "Somebody, why didn't anybody tell me this early?" And he had burnt all his years. Now he's tired and weak. He has a stroke. You know. So, number one, let's introduce service. We have a little time. We're closing this thing. I think I would be done in the next 15 minutes. So let's just make the most of this remaining moments. So we have an idea of what we're discussing, I guess. So this is a process. It's a process, okay? Number one, so one of the things you're going to begin to understand as a disciple in your church is service. What is service? Service is anything you're doing to help. It's as simple as that. Service doesn't mean slavery. Service is anything you are doing to make the work easier for another person. When you are offering your time, you're offering your skill, you're offering your gift, you're offering your finances, you're offering something that is aiding a work. That's what service is. So to serve means to be of help, to aid, to assist. And then every believer, every disciple must understand service. The pathway to honor is service. The pathway that leads to kingdom honor is service. If you want to experience honor, then you must understand service. There is no greatness in the kingdom without service. There is no destiny in the kingdom without service. There is no promotion in the kingdom without service. John chapter 12, Jesus made a very profound statement, and it's important we point it out. John chapter 12, let's hear Jesus himself talk about service. It says, verse 25, "He that loveth his life shall lose it. He that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life." Now see verse 26, "If any man serve me," I remember Pastor Edmond began his journey in those days in our campus fellowship. He later became a pastor. But he didn't start as a pastor. He began through the pathway of service. He was, was in the technical crew. And I think at one time, he also was in the drama department. You know, it was just all over the place, you know, looking for where to make himself available, you know, and he would follow me, would go for evangelism. He had a humble heart of a servant. So, and I know God is going to take him to high places he can't even imagine. If you understand service, you've caught the secret of the kingdom. If you understand service, you've caught the secret of the kingdom. He said, to others, these things are done in parables, but to you, it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom. The way up is not up. The way up is down. If you want to plant a tall tree, you don't throw the seed into the air. You take the seed and put it in the ground. He said, they will take root downwards, that they may bear fruit upwards. So if you want to go up in the kingdom, you don't jump. You bring yourself down, and God will take you up. See what Jesus said in John chapter 12, verse 26. He says, if any man, whether black, white, colored, rainbow, whatever is your color, tall, short, rich, poor, doesn't matter your status. If any man, and that includes women, if any man serve me, if any man serve me, let him follow me. If any man serve me, let him follow me. So the condition for being a disciple, which is a follower, is service. If you're not disposed towards serving, don't follow me. If you don't like the idea of serving, stay on your own. Let me stay my own. Don't bother following me around. Because I'm going to say things to you that will hurt your ego. I will say things to you that will attack your pride. I will say things to you and you will say, does he know who he's talking to? Please, please, please. If you don't have the heart of a servant, don't be my disciple. That's what it's saying there. If any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall also my servant be. Oh, hallelujah. I'm overexcited. I'm destroying the camera. It says, where I am, there also shall my servant be. Where is Jesus right now? Jesus is not inside you. What's inside you is the Holy Spirit. The Bible says Christ in you, not Jesus in you. You never hear the Bible say Jesus in you, because Jesus is in heaven, seated on the right hand of God. The physical Jesus, the man Jesus, the only man in heaven. Jesus is the only man that has blood in heaven. The only man in heaven, seated on the right hand of God. He said, where I am, there shall my servant also be. Wow, so that's scary. It tells you that rapture is for servants. He's coming for servants. He's coming for those who serve. He says, blessed is that servant who, when his master cometh, shall find him so doing. I tell you, he will make him the Lord of the household. When he comes, what will he find you doing? Where will he find you serving? Will he be sitting down pointing out, that sister can't sing, that brother is spoiling the song, that guy doesn't know how to play? It's easy to be a spectator. Have you ever seen them give the prize to spectators? The prize is given to participators. Don't sit in the church and be a spectator. The church is not a place for, it's not your kingdom. The church is God's kingdom, where all of us are called to serve. It is your Father's house. Where is your place of ministry? He said, say unto Archippus, let him take heed to the ministry which he has received in the Lord, that he fulfill it. You have a ministry. You have an assignment. You have a work. Your discipleship begins by locating your place of service. Are you in the choir? Go and serve God in the choir. Don't go to the choir to be seen. If you understand service, it doesn't matter who sings solo or who backs up. What is important is that you are doing your part, so that the one who you're doing it for, who is God in heaven, will reward you. Hallelujah. If you are doing it for a pastor, then a pastor will pay you. But if you are doing it for God, so the question is, who are you serving? Colossians chapter 3. I'm run out of time, but I got to drop these things before we go. He said, go and tell Pharaoh. He was telling Moses, go and tell Pharaoh. Tell him the Lord God of the Hebrews appeared to you, and he gave you this message. And this is the message you should tell Pharaoh. Tell him, let my people go, that they may go and pursue their lives. No. That they may go and chase after their dreams. No. That they may go and get married. No. Why should Pharaoh let you go? That they may serve me in the wilderness. So the purpose of your salvation is service. The purpose for which Pharaoh was told to release you was because God had need for you. He said to them, when you go, you will find a donkey tied to a post. Untie it and bring it to me. That's the more. You know, Christ, he spoke as a Lord there. How do you go to untie somebody's donkey and bring? He said, if the owner will ask you, what doest thou? Tell him, the master has need of it. The master has need of it. The master has need of it. Because the master has need of you, Satan had to let you go. Because the master has need of you, Satan had to be the power of darkness had to be broken from your life. And I'm speaking to you, operating under satanic bondage, because there is a call for you. I command that yoke to break in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. He said, loose him and bring him. Loose him and bring him. I command you to be loose now from ancestral curses. Loose from everything that is tying you down. Loose from the hand of Pharaoh. Loose from the power of death. Loose from that sickness that doesn't want to let you go. Loose in the name of Jesus. He said, loose him. If they ask you, why are you releasing the donkey? Tell him that the master, because the will of God overrules every other thing happening in your life. Hallelujah. And because of that, Pharaoh had to let them go. God Hallelujah. Needs you. That's why he saved you. God Hallelujah. Needs you. That's why he Amen. Saved you. God needs you. That's Amen. Why he saved you. God needs Amen. You. That's why he saved you. God Amen. Needs you. Amen. You were saved to profit him. God never does anything that doesn't profit him. Everything God does, he does for his own benefit. He saved you for himself, for his purpose, not for you, but for him. You were bought with a price. A price was paid. You were purchased from the slave market of hell, and you are brought into the kingdom of God to offer yourself to him as a living sacrifice. Hallelujah. Tell him, let my people go, that they may serve me. So you are saved to serve. Repeat after me, saved to serve. Place your hand on your chest and say, saved to serve. Say, Lord, I'm reporting to duty. Saved to serve. Command me, Jesus. Saved to serve. I'm here, Lord. Saved to serve. What should I do for you? I like the attitude of Apostle Paul when he was Saul. From the moment of his apprehension, from the moment God arrested him, and he fell down and broke his waist. Well, he was from the donkey when Jesus appeared to him and said to him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? You know what came out of his mouth? Who art thou, Lord? Because whoever knocked me down must be a Lord. Who art thou, Lord? He said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. The next question was not, what is my blessing? Or what do you have for me? No, that's not what he asked him. He said, what shall I do for you, Lord? He understood that when you meet the Lord, you surrender yourself as a servant. And because he had the attitude of service from day one, he became the greatest of all the apostles that ever lived. He said, I labored more than all the apostles. He said, but not I, but the grace of God. The grace of God is not a lazy thing. It's not a lazy spirit. When real grace comes upon you, you will start looking for what to do. When real grace hits you, you can't be lazy. When real grace hits you, you can't be idle in the church. When real grace hits you, you will be busy for God. Grace is a busy spirit. Grace is a workaholic. Grace does not sit down when others are walking. You can't carry grace and sit down. You can't carry grace and be idle. You can't carry grace and let others do all the work. I release grace upon you. Receive the laboring grace. Command the Lord. What can I do here, Lord? He said, the branch that does not bear fruit, I cut it off. God has zero tolerance for unfruitfulness. God has zero tolerance. You have no excuse to be idle. You have no excuse to be fruitless in the kingdom. He has given you salvation. He has given you the word. He has given you the Holy Spirit. He has planted you in a church where you are being loved and cared for. He has given you a pastor who he gave as a gift. You know your pastor is a gift from God. He gave them pastors. God gives pastors. He gave you a pastor. He has given you everything. He gave you the Holy Ghost. He gave you the power. So why will you not bear fruits? You will bear fruit. He will bear fruits. He said, the branch that bears fruit, he prunes. So when you begin to produce, he begins to remove those things that affect you. He begins to cut off that sickness. He begins to cut off that thing, those bondages, so you can produce more. Start with where you are. Find a place. Don't be content anymore to sit. He said, the Son of God said, I am among you, not as him that is served, but I've come, I'm among you as him that serveth. He said, don't I have right to sit down for you to serve me? But I'm not taking the position. That's Jesus talking. I am not taking the position as the one who is being served. But I'm here to serve. If Jesus came to serve, then who are you? Who am I? He said, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. That even though he was God, he did not go after his right as God. He put those things aside and took the form of a servant. Because if you're going to go to the top, you must present yourself as a servant. If you want to get to the top, you can't come as whatever name you call yourself. You must humble yourself and say, Lord, here I am. Let's take one more scripture and we're out of here. Colossians chapter 3, let's see verse 23. Let's take a few seconds and pray in the spirit. I'm feeling anointing right now. Let's pray a little. Just surrender yourself. Surrender yourself to him and say, Lord, my God, I belong to you. I belong to you. I belong to you. The price was paid for me. There is no idle member of your physical body. There is no idle member. Every part of your body has what is doing your body. You're a member of the body of Christ. You can't be idle. When a body receives so much but doesn't give anything, we call it cancerous. We call it a growth. And what do you do with growths? Cut them off. For everything you receive, there is an expected result. Hallelujah. For to him much is given, much is expected. Some of us have received much. Much. Every Sunday we hear a new word. Every Sunday you hear, you get to receive it. Where is the fruit of it? It says in Colossians chapter 1, it says, hallelujah. Verse 22, servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. Don't be a mouth pleaser. Don't do it because somebody's watching you. Do it because God is watching you. See verse 23, and whatsoever you do, do it heartily. Do it heartily. As if you are doing it for the Lord because you are doing it for the Lord. The one receiving that service in the church, whether you sing in the choir, whether you are sweeping the church, whether you are fixing the equipment, the person who is receiving your service is not the pastor. The pastor is representing the person we are really serving. The one you are really serving is Christ. So when you are singing, sing for Jesus. When you are praying, pray for Jesus. When you're going for evangelism, do it for Jesus. And I ask a question, I ask everywhere. If you knew Jesus was the receiver of your service, is this how you would serve him? Is there a possibility that you would do better than you're doing now, knowing fully well that it's not unto man, but unto God? He said, do it as heartily or as unto the Lord, Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. Do it heartily. That means let it come from your heart. Don't wait until you are coerced or forced or threatened. Any service done out of coercion or, you know, force is caused by God. God is too big for you not to serve him. Think about the creator of heaven and earth that serves every day himself. What is that thing you can do for him? What is that thing that is too much for him? God said, if it's not according to my this requirement, I will not accept it. God doesn't accept every offering. Ask Cain. God doesn't accept just anything. He doesn't take just anything. If it's for God you are doing it, do it heartily. See him on the receiving end that I am doing this. So whether the church claps for you or not, whether the pastor remembers to mention your name on the pulpit or not, whether they give you a gift at the end of the year or not, whether they do this or not, you know that it's not for them. Yes, they are the direct recipients, but I am doing this for God. He sees me. And I want to say to somebody, he sees you. He watches you. He knows you. And the time is coming, he will promote you. See, as we tie it up in verse 24, it says, do it with a knowing. See, verse 24. Knowing, I love this Bible. Knowing that of the Lord. So when I'm serving, when I'm preaching, when I'm teaching, when I'm taking care of the children, when I'm fixing the mic, when I'm fixing the equipment, when I'm running the errands, when I'm doing all I'm doing, exercising myself, knowing, do it with a knowing that of the Lord, not of the church, but of the Lord. Thank God the church may appreciate you, may do some stuff for you, but that's not comparable to what the Lord is going to do for you. I'm talking to somebody. I perceive in my spirit that your time of reward has come. There's somebody in this church who has labored. God said, I will honor you this year. There's honor coming. He says, him shall my Father honor. If we go back to John chapter 12, verse 26, he said, him that serveth me shall my Father honor. There's honor coming. I release honor upon your head. In the name of Jesus Christ. He said, knowing that of the Lord you shall receive the reward of the inheritance. For, see the last part, for you serve the Lord Christ. So who are you serving? You serve the Lord Christ. Who am I serving? I serve, that's why I am tireless. That's why I am constantly motivated. That's why I am always inspired. That's why I don't get affected by attitudes and behavior and bad treatment or whatever it is anybody saying or doing, because I'm not doing for them. I am doing for the Lord who will reward me. Who will reward you? I thank God for the reward of man, but I prefer the reward of God. I prefer the reward of God. I want God's reward. What about you? He says you shall receive from him. You can't walk in one company and go to another company to collect your salary. It doesn't work like that. So you cannot be working for yourself or for somebody and go to God to pay you. No, it is only those that were working for him that he owes salary, and God pays well. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus said, he that reapeth receiveth wages. God pays well. Tomorrow I will talk about the benefits of service. God pays well. God pays well. Bring out yourself fully. Don't hold yourself back. Don't say, it's not my ministry, so I won't kill myself. No, the Bible says, if you have not been found faithful in another man's own, who shall give your own? So God is judging you now by how you are handling where you are right now to know what you want, how you do the one in the future. If you are not faithful where you are now, you will not see the next level. For he that is faithful in little shall be faithful in much. Lift your hands and say, thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to serve you. It's a privilege to serve God. It's a privilege to serve God. It's a privilege to serve God. Just lift your hands wherever you are. We are done for tonight. I pray that the Lord has made an impartation somehow. Pray, come on, Rabo Shandera. Thank you, Lord. Tell him I will serve you better. I will do it better now. I didn't know it was you. I didn't know it was you. I didn't know it was you, Lord. Unto the Lord. It is for 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 the Lord. Receive a baptism of service. Receive a fresh baptism of service. Receive a fresh anointing of service. Amen. The him that serveth me shall my father honor. Honor is not a gift. Honor is a reward for service. I see God honoring you this day. I see God giving honor upon your destiny. What is honor? Honor is when people naturally care and attention. Honor is when your word doesn't fall on the ground without happening. Honor is when God sees every aspect of you seriously. Mandara Baba, honor is coming on your life. Even your whisper is a prayer. Even your joke is a prayer. Honor. It's when God takes everything you say as a word and he brings it to pass. Receive this a new anointing of honor. Mandaka Baba doske delebra baba. Somebody's not praying. Kababa, receive a baptism of service. Step into the kingdom. Step into the until you are serving, you're not in the kingdom. You are in church, but you're not in the kingdom. You are in church, but you're not in the kingdom. Until you are a servant, you are not yet in the kingdom. Mandata kababa doske delebra baba. For the Lord dwells in that I hear. You are not yet his until you are serving. He said, no weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue that rises against you in judgment you shall condemn. But this is the heritage of the servants of God. All the promises of the Bible are for servants.
Oh, yes,
all the promises of the Bible are for servants. It's not for everybody. Step into the kingdom. Step into your destiny. Your destiny does not begin until you find the place of service. Your destiny does not begin until you locate your place of service. Elisha began by pouring water in the hands of Elijah. From pouring water in the hands of Elijah, from the greatest prophets in his time. He said he came to Joshua, who was Moses' minister, Moses' servant. It is from master to servant. Power flows from master to servant. Power flows from master to servant. Promotion. When a servant, when one person goes down, God lifts a servant to replace him. Receive the anointing of service. Receive the spirit of discipleship. Receive the kingdom. Receive a new mindset. Let pride die. Let self die. Let Jesus live in you. Thank you, Father. I give you all the glory. I give you all the honor. I give you all praise. Oh, hallelujah to your name. Glory, glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him
glory,
praise.
Glory.
Give him praise. Give him praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. All glory, right. Thank you for having me tonight. I will hand over back to my host, and then I will leave you to keep contemplating on what the Holy Ghost has done tonight. I'll see you tomorrow. God bless you and keep you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Pastor. Thank you for tonight. Thank you for delivering God's word to us. We appreciate you. We love you. And we know that God is increasing his grace and unction upon you. Amen. You are touching more and more people all over the world. God bless you, sir. We thank you.
God bless
Hallelujah. You. Amen. Praise the living God. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. I would like some response. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I pray and I trust God that you have been blessed tonight. Amen.
Yes, sir. You
know, so much has been said. So much has been said. Praise God. But, you know, this is the word of God. This is the word of God. If we want to be vessels that the Lord can use, vessels that the Lord can entrust, we must know these things. We must hear these things. Amen. Sometimes the things that we are hearing may be uncomfortable, you know, to us. But you see, if it gets uncomfortable, it means that the flesh is being dealt with. Praise God. The Bible talks about in a great house, and I'll talk about this on Sunday. In a great house, there are some vessels that are unto honor and some unto dishonor. Why is that? Praise God. Why is that? Why does that happen? What, some vessels are unto honor, while others are unto dishonor. The ones that God will use, and that's what the scripture says, the one that God will use are the ones that are unto honor. Those are the ones that he can use. Those are the ones that have been sanctified. Those are the ones that have been set apart by him. Praise God. So we are hearing these things so that we can begin to operate at the level God wants us to operate, as individuals first. As individuals first. Praise God. He wants to deal with self. Remember the scripture I read to you yesterday about Naaman. Naaman did not want to do what Elisha had told him to go and do because he came with certain airs. And God cannot work with you that way. If you come with airs, and the Bible says that Naaman came with style. Glory to God. So these things are for our own lifting. It says that the man of God may be thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So I really pray that you have been blessed. My note is full here, you know. Service, you know, is a pathway to honor. And then what he said about saved to serve. I'm saved to serve. I'm saved. It's in my mindset. It's in my DNA. Praise God. It's in my DNA. I work in a top investment bank. Even if tomorrow I become the managing director of that bank, what is in my head is that God has lifted me to that place to serve him for his purpose. Glory to God. So I'm telling you this, that it's God that lifts. It's God that rewards. It's God that increases. Whatever we are now and today, God made us that for his purpose. For he's the one that is at work in us, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. It's for his benefit. It's for his pleasure. So if you're a brilliant person, that's excellent. If you are good at school, that's good. But know that the reason why God has put that gift and skill and ability inside of you is for his divine purpose. If you miss it, you miss everything. You miss everything. Glory to God. So it's a blessed night. Tomorrow we continue. Amen. Tomorrow we start earlier because we know we have Sunday service Sunday morning. So tomorrow we're going to start at 4:30. You know, I want to encourage you to come in early. 4:30 would kick off. We're having a glorious time. It's going from one level of glory to the other. You know, when you come for a conference like this, there's need for patience. Praise God. There's need for patience. Settle down and say, I'm going to receive what God has for me. Amen. I'm going to receive what he has for me. Hallelujah. So we're going to start early tomorrow. Amen. We had some technical issues today. I apologize and I thank you for your patience staying on. I think one or two people left at that time, but it's good to be patient because if you stay to the end, you will receive it. That's scripture. So I want to apologize to everyone, you know, for the technical issues. By the grace of God, you know, we would have it better tomorrow. But sometimes these things are not dependent on us because he's ministering from Nigeria. There could be issues with, you know, the lines there and all that. But just be patient. Settle down and say that nothing is going to distract me from what God has in stock for me. Praise God. I also want to encourage you to give your offerings. That is important. Praise God. You know, give your offerings, pay your tithes. Hallelujah. That's one of the hallmarks of disciples. Praise God. You know, so I want to encourage you. The details are there. Glory to God. You know, the details are there. Please go and, you know, either do it, transfer it to the account, you know, and all that. But it's of great help to us. That's what I can say. It's of great help to us. So I want to encourage you to do so. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, on Saturday, tomorrow, we plan to have Q&A. If there are questions, because if there are no questions, you know, well, I'm not going to manufacture them anyway. If you do have questions, please send them to myself, Pastor Chinelo, or to the number that you normally get text messages from. Send it before 12 noon tomorrow so that we can put it all together. If I don't see any questions, it means that there aren't any questions. So if you have any burning questions in your heart or, you know, something you want to pour out and all that, and you want to know from scripture what it's about, please, I want to encourage you to send in your questions before 12 noon to tomorrow afternoon so that we can have it all ready before the session starts by 4:30 p.m. Praise God. And then just before we leave, today's Brother Emeka's birthday. I don't know if he's online.